Hello. Today we are going to talk about how Indian weddings and corporate mergers are similar. Before I begin the video, I would like to put a disclaimer that this is not about arranged marriage versus love marriage, and this is also not about who chooses the bride or groom for whom. This is just about how a typical Indian wedding is organized and what we can learn from it for a merger or acquisition process. And these are purely my views based on my experience of attending and organizing Indian weddings and also studying about a lot of corporate mergers. So let's begin the video with 6 topics. Beginning with the search, then approval. This approval would come at multiple places. Execution, who has what type of incentive to make the wedding or the merger work? What type of communication is adopted and how would the life after the wedding or the merger be? So let's start with the search. In a typical Indian wedding, be it love marriage or arranged marriage, the search process involves family members. And there are different parties that contribute towards searching for the bride or the groom. And there are many reasons for choosing a particular community or a particular family or a particular person to be suitable for your, say, daughter or son. And the first reason for that is that both families should be compatible. A typical Indian wedding looks at marrying between similar families, between similar cultures, so that both the families are compatible for this thing that we spoke about called the life after. If you have similar communities, similar families, it becomes very easy for the groom or the bride to adjust between both the families. Now, the second reason why people choose a certain type of person or community is because of their aspiration to grow in their life. This is probably, I would say, instant upgradation of your life. If you're from a particular family and you marry into a family that is much richer or much well off than you, then you definitely have an instant upgradation of your life. There are a lot of people who do that. Similarly, an instant gratification solution could be that if you're looking for a person with a certain quality, you go ahead and search for brides or grooms in that particular section of the community. Then, of course, you explore opportunities where you have synergy, where two families who are looking for growth in mutual business, growth in general community ties, you go for synergy between both the families. So the search process itself involves a lot of criteria based on which different marriages have different types of search criteria, and therefore possibly that is one reason how your corporate merger and acquisition targets are identified. Now the search process in fact involves a lot of stakeholders. Same with a corporate merger, where if in an Indian wedding your stakeholders would be your family, your friends, your well-wishers, your mentors. In a corporate merger, your stakeholders would be the government, regulator, investors, employees, customers, suppliers, community, media, etc. At the end of the day, all of them influence what type of search criteria you use and what type of partners you identify for the next step. The next step, which is definitely the approval step. As in an Indian wedding, where the approval usually comes from elders of the household, and this is possibly very similar to what happens in a corporate merger, where you have the investors or the financiers providing the approval. But you also need to take into consideration other family members who possibly will be impacted by this decision. So if, for example, there are two siblings and you go ahead and get one sibling married in a particular type of family, and then you were also worried about the other sibling. And similarly, the corporate merger would also look at family, which is basically your customers, your employees, your shareholders, who would also be impacted from your decision, not just financially, but culture wise, performance wise, availability of your products in the market, and n number of things that would definitely impact other entities that have interest in your companies, in both the companies that are considering a merger. And when it comes to approval, a lot of people are also kept outside the approval process because, like I said, because they have different incentives. So what you need to also take care is whom to keep out of this process. When I talk about incentive, let me talk about an Indian wedding and what type of incentives exist for people in Indian weddings. So there are people who come there only for the attendance, who just want to attend your wedding, the actual event. For example, there are relatives who just need to do this because this is a formality. There are people whose lives depend on this wedding, for example the bride and the groom, and so they are much more invested in making this work. Then there are people who just want to get this done because it was on their plate and they need to do it. There are people who are genuinely interested in the well-being of the bride and the groom and the families, and therefore their intention is to have a long-term approach towards this particular wedding. Then there are people who are there for the gifts, then there are people who are there for the drama, who are there for financing it, who are there to make a business out of it. There are people who are there just because they want importance during the rituals and during the execution, and a lot of other stakeholders who have different kinds of incentives. So if we look at the major types of stakeholders that are present in an Indian wedding and in a corporate merger, we can make a table saying these are my stakeholders, these are their incentives, and this is how I need to keep them happy. And therefore there are two things that need to be considered when keeping your stakeholders happy and giving them the incentives that they want. So the first thing is communication, and the second thing is involving them in the execution. In communication, like in an Indian wedding, not everybody comes to know about the wedding at every stage. There are some people who come to know that a wedding is being planned at the search stage. There are some people who come to know it after the approval has been given. Some people who just come to know 1 or 2 days before the wedding. Some people who come to know even after the wedding. So the communication depends on the stakeholder, their incentive, their importance in making this work. And therefore, the timing of the communication also depends based on those factors. Similarly, in a corporate merger, the people who come to know that a merger is being planned are different from the people who approve it and the people who actually gain out of it. And therefore, you need to plan your communication accordingly. And when we talk about communication, not everybody communicates to every stakeholders. For example, at the search stage, the parents and the bride or the groom communicate to their well-wishers and say, I'm looking for a particular partner. Can you help me find one? And when it comes to the approval stage, maybe it's the elders of the household who go ahead and communicate that this decision has been taken, and not necessarily the other members of the family, like siblings and stuff like that. Therefore, even in a corporate merger, you need to look at different departments who would do the communication and who would receive the communication at different points in time, depending on what information needs to be shared at what point in time. Now, coming to the execution part, to make a wedding work, that is, to make just the wedding ritual work, we need a lot of people to join hands and collaborate. And therefore, the communication, the involvement, and the incentive are closely tied with the execution process. There are people who need to run around, there are people who need to do the planning, who need to do the purchasing, there are people who need to keep engaging with guests during the wedding. And so, you need to ensure that you involve all relevant stakeholders to make that activity a success. Similarly, when the merger happens, you need to take care of the execution part to ensure that the merger process, like the regulation, the regulators, the financiers, the customers, etc., are not affected during the particular event. And then, of course, the most important thing after all this has been done is the life after. But before coming to life after, I told you that I would like to talk more about approval. Like I said, the approval process is not just at the search phase. The approval process is at every stage. So when, for example, the stakeholders who are responsible for execution come up with 3 sets of plans saying that we should have the wedding at this time, at this venue, with this sort of a combination of guests, this guy again goes ahead and gives an approval because he possibly has the purse strings, or he possibly is the decision maker in the family. And same is the case for corporate mergers, right? So at the end of the day, this approval layer does have significance at each stage, but I personally think that their role reduces as we progress towards completing the wedding. And then the life after is also very important. We usually stop till execution of the wedding and then say have a happy married life, right? But at the end of the day, in order to make this marriage work, in order to make this merger work, all the stakeholders that had different incentives to complete the marriage wedding process should also be involved in the life after, so that if there are any problems, they could offer counseling, they could offer financial help, they could offer any sort of assistance that would be essential for this bride and groom to make their marriage successful. And so in India, we usually have a lot of rituals and a lot of relatives coming and going around, a lot of festivals, a lot of cultural elements that take place in the first 1 year of the wedding, so that there is heavy monitoring on the couple in the first 1 year to ensure that any issues, any problems they may have can be resolved easily by speaking to them. If you leave them alone, I'm again not talking about what is good and what is not good, what works and what doesn't work. In all these cultural nuances, overdoing anything could lead to problem. What I'm talking about is that we do have a nice framework that helps the couple cope up with the changes that they have soon after the wedding for the first 1.5 years, so that their life after is smooth. And therefore, a corporate merger should probably also focus on what measures need to be taken once the merger happens. What cultural issues can they face? What compatibility issues can they face? How would their customers be impacted? How would their employees be impacted? What sorts of incentives went wrong? What sorts of incentives went right? What sort of communication is required in addition to what was already done, and stuff like that. So I feel that the Indian wedding process has a lot to teach us for our corporate merger process, and I feel personally that they both are very similar.